So basically, it's getting back to what our species should eat, you know? And if we can understand that, we could get there. Today, what's running the world is, of course, money, right? I mean, this is a... packages should only be for holidays, but we have these kind of things. And we're all in the same paradigm, you know, because we're all doing what other people do without really thinking, because there's so many things going on that we can't think about it. Yet, I often tell people that if you want to just find out, I conduct a 21-day disease reversal holiday. It's a beautiful holiday in a lovely resort, and we do lab tests in the beginning, and then we have fun and we eat. And then we do lab reports at the end. And while they're getting better, I actually cut off the medications. So that by the end of 21 days, people are off a lot of the medications, 70%, some all, and they have no more. I mean, the lab reports are better than they were when they came in. And that's how fast our body can heal. Yesterday, you know, on the 8th of February, I did a reversing diabetes seminar, and yesterday I had a meeting of people who had been at that reversing diabetes seminar, changed their diets, and in within 21 days, they were talking about what results they had achieved in 21 days. So that's how fast our body can heal, and yet we are not accessing that power. So that was just about food, and I can tell you a little bit more about food. That what I ask people to do is a whole plant-based diet. Basically, what we would be instinctually drawn to. So fruits, vegetables, you know that even herbivores like goats and cows eat different things. So if we eat as much as possible in our niche, which is fruits, vegetables, nuts, and seeds. Just to give an example, if you saw a field of wheat or rice, what do you feel like doing?
Taking pictures.
Taking pictures, maybe singing or whatever, Hindi movie style, you know. But you don't feel like eating it, and that's because you're not a cow. Yet, grains have become our staple. You know, birds eat grains, cows eat grains, but it's not instinctually our food. So if we could just narrow down to the foods which are instinctually suitable for us, and it's really amazing that you can make cakes and pasta and everything from foods which are good for us, and we don't really have to go to the foods which are not. So we can get healthy just by eating the right fuel for our body. And you know, human beings are the only species that systematically make our food less nutritious before we eat it. So if we have sugar cane, we extract sugar. Now, how much sugar cane can a diabetic have? Actually, as much as they want, because nature has already put the stops. If you were to eat sugar cane like this and like this, how much can you do? This, right? Max. But if we make it into sugarcane juice or jaggery or sugar, then we can eat a lot. And you know, we are instinctually we like sweet. So if you were to go to a farm or an orchard and see fruits or vegetables, what would you choose? So when we are reversing diabetes, they can have as much fruit as they want. Because fruit is a natural food for human beings, and their blood sugar will go down. But we can't have fruit juice, for example, which is a refined product where the fiber is removed, because nature is very wise that where there's a lot of fat or there's a lot of sugar, there's a lot of fiber. And this fiber cleans our body, you know. Now, if we think about our natural food as a whole plant-based diet, then we actually can see how we are causing the climate change and things today.
I have a question.
Yes.
When we're talking about this plant diet,
yes,
but we also know that we put so the farmers are using a lot of chemicals as well.
Right.
So
that's a good question. So maybe I should just move forward and answer these questions before I go here. I'll answer her and then I'll answer yours and then we go back to where we were. So farmers are putting a lot of pesticides and actually we should eat organic. So I always ask people to eat organic, but if we eat animal products, say we drink milk, and it takes 12 kilos of grain to produce 1 liter of milk, then we've got a lot more pesticide in the milk. For example, the Indian Council of Medical Research has done a study of 50,000 samples, and you can just look this up. 50,000 samples over 7 years of milk in India. And they found that on an average, HCH, which is a residual pesticide, the levels of HCH in milk in India was 570 times the permissible allowance. So when we are consuming higher on the food chain, we've automatically got all the pesticides that that animal ate. And so even if you were to eat conventionally grown food, which is not recommended, you're eating less pesticides if you don't eat animal products. Mm-hmm. You know? Also, we think that you can peel vegetables and you will get rid of pesticide, but it's not true because the pesticides go right to the center of the... You know, if you spray a coconut tree with pesticide at the bottom, you will get pesticide in the water in the coconut above. So we can't peel or wash pesticides off. And so the only solution is actually to eat food that was grown the way God intended it to be grown.
I would like to share something. I have a friend who rears butterflies. So she gave me a caterpillar. And the only thing that I was supposed to feed it was curry leaves. Mm-hmm. So it went well for a week. My sister-in-law gets food from Damdaris. I got it and I had to buy it from local store and give it. I washed it nicely and yet the caterpillar died. And we eat that curry leaves after washing.
Actually, we eat things, we spray things so that no other animal will eat. And they have instincts enough not to eat and we eat it. Isn't that like, wow. Anyhow. Yeah.
So why do you think our palate is designed that way? So for instance, there are a set of fruits there and there's a pizza kept. I would want to go and eat the pizza first. So
right.
Why do you think our palate didn't evolve with it? And why does it still accept tasty food?
Actually, our palates evolved this way. You know, there are certain things which are addictive. For example, sugar is addictive, oil is addictive, or oil and fat is addictive, salt is addictive. And manufacturers know this. So if they put things in the right combination, you can open a bag of potato chips, you can't put it down till you finish. You open a bag of biscuits, you can't put it down. Now, if you have a plate of carrots, you won't eat beyond your hunger, you know? So we are making food addictive. For example, a child would love to eat out rather than eat at home. Because if you go to McDonald's, I'm just saying McDonald's, I mean all fast food or other food as well, they put sugar in everything. So that it's addictive, you know? So we are making things addictive so that we will never stop eating them. And then we are suffering from the consequences of never stopping eating. For example, you know, I said refining, and we even refined rice.
Right.
So instead of having whole rice, say if we were to eat rice, I actually do allow my reversing diabetes patients to eat rice because I don't take away everything. If I'm taking away all the animal products and the oil and the sugar, then I don't go to rice. I do stage one of health, but they can even reverse diabetes by eating rice, but it needs to be whole rice because when we take off the skin of the rice, then we automatically eat double. You know, have you ever eaten whole rice and white rice? When you eat whole rice, you eat only half, right? If you peel all your vegetables, you eat more. If you peel your rice, you eat more. If you have white bread compared to whole bread, you eat more. And then what we get is calories, calories, calories instead of nutrition. So going back to the calcium story, since you asked me this, human breast milk contains 33 milligrams per 100 grams of calcium. Now, cow's milk contains more, 120. But when a human baby is born, it has no teeth, no bones, you know, everything soft, drop a baby, no fracture, because everything's soft, all cartilage, and it has to yet ossify. Yet, This is the amount of calcium we need. Now, all green leafy vegetables, nuts and seeds contain more calcium than human milk. Even potato chips contains more calcium than human milk. And sesame seeds contains 1,160, but nobody's talking about sesame. They're all talking about milk. But the truth is that anyway, nobody has low intake of calcium because everybody's eating some green leafy vegetables, nuts and seeds, or if not, potato chips. So we are getting enough calcium because we're getting at least the amount which a human baby gets. And we actually don't need more as a percentage. So we are getting, that's why giving all that calcium never cures anybody, because calcium deficiency was not the problem. Calcium intake deficiency is not the problem. What is happening though, is that we're flushing all the calcium out. So let me just explain this. Should I explain this right now?
Yeah.
Okay. So our body is alkaline. And whenever we consume something which is acidic, then we need to neutralize that to keep the status quo in our body all the time. So for example, if you drank a glass of Coke, Coke is pure acid, contains sugar, phosphoric acid and caffeine, all are acidic. If you drank a glass of Coke, immediately calcium needs to come out of your bones to neutralize the acid in the Coke. And you can do an experiment by taking a glass of Coke and putting your fingernails in, and you'll see that they're gone the next morning. So, also protein.
Fingernails
dissolve because it's acid.
I've heard that's an urban legend.
Try it. And it's easy to try, right?
So, a lot of people actually justify that. They talk about, you know, your stomach more acid than anything can talk about. They talk all these things, but they're missing the basic point. The acids are there to digest food, and the acids are not there in your teeth. When you're drinking the Coke, your teeth is also experiencing that acidic environment, so you're losing the
Actually, acid. Our stomach also doesn't have enough acid to digest animal products, which is why if you were to go to McDonald's, what would you order to drink?
Coke.
Yeah. Right? Because we don't have enough acid to digest the protein in animal products. If you were to go to a nice French restaurant and order a steak, what would you order to drink? Again, acid. So, and that's why if you go to vegetarian restaurants, because traditionally vegetarian restaurants weren't serving what they serve today, vegetarian restaurants don't serve alcohol, even though alcohol is not non-vegetarian, but non-vegetarian restaurants serve alcohol because if you're eating non-veg, you need alcohol. Now, today vegetarian restaurants actually need the same thing because, you know, vegetarians and non-vegetarians are getting the same illness, diabetes, hypertension, cancer, the whole works, obesity and all, because milk and meat have the same composition, high protein, high fat and no fiber. So when a vegetarian goes out to eat, they order paneer, non-vegetarian chicken, we're all in the same boat. So basically, because milk is also not a food for humans. So basically we have to get back to what a species should eat, which is what we saw in Hungry for Change.
But why would you think the doctors still go ahead and say calcium is essential for a strong bone?
Calcium is essential for a strong bone. That is true. Okay. But the thing is that we don't have a lack. So we have to understand what is the cause of calcium deficiency, and it's not lack of intake. So taking more will only add to kidney stones, but it will not solve the problem because, you know, we still need to take out every time we eat high protein. Protein breaks down into amino acids. It's acidic in our body. We need to take calcium out of the bones to neutralize it. And so we're losing calcium with every high protein meal. So food also is connected to climate change because, you know, the UN and FAO have written a report, 400-page report called Livestock's Long Shadow, which states that livestock produce more greenhouse gases than all the vehicles on the planet. Trains, planes and cars combined. And you start thinking, how is that possible that these poor animals create all that much pollution? But if we understand the number of animals we're eating today, so we are 7 billion on the planet. The land animals alone slaughtered for food are more than 69 billion per year. more than 69 billion, and they take water. It takes 500 liters of water to produce 1 kilo of potatoes, 600 for 1 kilo of wheat, 2,000 for 1 kilo of rice, but 100,000 for a kilo of beef. So livestock are consuming the water. Land resources, it takes a lot of land to produce animals that we eat. So 12 to 6 kilos of grain to produce 1 liter of meat or milk. A non-vegetarian needs 16 acres to survive on. A vegetarian can even live on, a vegan, not eating animal products, can even live on a quarter acre for a family of five. And actually, we are teaching people how to grow all the food that they need on a quarter acre for a family of five in order to make them self-sufficient. And energy. The world's petroleum reserves would last for only 13 years if all humans were meat eaters, but 260 years. Why? Because eating animals is energy intensive. I'm just going to give you a quick example of why. Let's just take milk. So, what is the energy that goes into producing milk? All the fertilizers and pesticides that go into growing the grains, which is also petroleum based. And then those grains that are harvested and transported, again, energy, and fed to the animals. And then those animals are milked, again, energy. That milk is taken to the dairy, pasteurized, homogenized, energy, packed in plastic bags, which comes from petrol, again, energy, refrigerated because all animal products are decaying substances. So refrigerated, and then sent to the consumer, and again refrigerated. So it's a lot of energy if you compare it to carrots or apples, right? So when we consume animal products, we're also wasting a lot of energy. And, you know, so many people could be saved of starvation if we were not busy feeding animals that would feed us, and then it goes higher on the food chain. So what are the benefits of a plant-based diet? And you already saw, you know, your skin glows, and I'm just going to show you a quick video.
All right, wait until you meet this woman that's sitting next to me. She's from Ramona. She has been named the sexiest vegetarian over 50. The thing is, she's 70. Mimi, good morning. Mimi Kirk is here. Young at heart, vegetarian for what? 40 years now.
40 years.
And I guess that's what you attribute your youth and your beauty to.
That, I think that, and green drinks and maybe a little peroxide, but.
Yeah. That doesn't hurt, right? So how did this all happen? First of all, I want to say that it was for over 50.
Right.
And you are 20 years older than 50. Right. Were you the oldest person in the country?
I was way older. In fact, most of the women could have been my daughter, and some of the men could have been my daughter, but I saw this little ad pop up on Facebook, and I thought, I'm going to enter that contest, never really thinking this would all happen, but
right.
It's really fun.
And we have your Facebook page up, as a matter of fact, and I was looking at it, and it's beautiful. You have your Del Mar hat out. There you are, looking like a socialite at the track. Opening day, of course. You can spot the Del Mar hat from a mile away, but it's a great Facebook page picture you have there, and so people started voting then.
Yes, well, people started voting for me, and I went on Facebook and asked my Facebook friends to vote for me. And once I was one of the 10 finalists, there was a small article written, and then all kinds of people were contacting me after that, asking for my longevity secrets.
Right, exactly. Yeah. Well, what are they? First of all, why did you become a vegetarian? It was 40 years ago, so you were 30.
30. I was
30. And a lot of people want to see your ID, by the way.
Everybody has.
Quick, what year were you
ID.
Born?
1938.
All right. We believe you.
I just started to really think about animals, that I didn't want to eat animals. And then I started to realize the cruelty to the animal, the inhumane treatment of them. And now I think people are very conscious about their health. And, you know, beef has hormones and chickens are trapped in cages. I just think it's really a sad situation for the animals. They're inhumanely treated. And obviously you don't need that for your protein and to be healthy, because I feel like I'm 20. I wake up with no aches and pains.
Yeah.
I feel very, very good.
Wow, that is awesome. So what do you do? You know, I talk to a lot of people because I'm a vegetarian too. I don't eat meat, and I haven't for almost 30 years, right? So people
see
say,
how
well,
young he looks?
Well, I'm actually 84, which is really good. I'm much older. I know you wouldn't date me. I'm an older man. In any event, people say, well, where do you get your protein from?
Well, I know that's the first thing everybody asks. Yeah. And I eat lots of greens and I eat nuts and I don't eat any dairy products because I'm actually a vegan. I don't eat cheese or anything.
Right.
And I feel I'm not lacking anything. I fix a nice big green drink every morning with all kinds of greens and fruit. And I make beautiful desserts, cheesecake and stuff out of nut base. And I don't feel like I'm lacking any vitamins. My doctor says I'm in perfect health. My cholesterol's dropped like 26 points. I don't wake up with any arthritic pain. And I just think more people have to incorporate vegetarian live food. Healthy food. Yeah. I buy all my stuff at the outdoor markets, the farmers markets. I support them completely.
And of course, attitude is a lot. Huh?
And attitude is a lot. I feel
you have a youthful attitude.
I do. I feel very happy. I'm lucky. I feel glad to be alive when I wake up in the morning. And I try to see the best in everything. And even myself as I age, I try to just accept it. I've had no plastic surgery or Botox or anything.
Yeah, well, good for you. Now, the kids, what about the kids and the grandkids? What do they think about all this?
Oh, they love it. Especially my kids love it. My grandkids just think they have a hot grandma. They think it's so great. They posted on their Facebook, vote for my grandma, she's hot. And,
that's so awesome.
So why did Mimi do it for the animals? And I told you that SHARAN stands for Sanctuary for Health and Reconnection to Animals and Nature. And actually, if you watch animals, you can understand what to eat, how to eat, whether to drink while you're eating. Because if all the animals are doing it, then why do we write rules for ourselves? Animals don't go around with calorie charts, and yet they are always reasonably healthy and not overweight. So why did Mimi do it for the animals? And I just want to show you a film about factory farming, which shows what we're doing today in order that we can eat animals.
For economic efficiency has led here to filthy, overcrowded, industrialized farms that threaten our health, pollute our environment, and subject billions of animals to intolerable cruelty. Each is a sentient being endowed with awareness and feeling. To agribusiness, they are mere commodities, raw materials on an assembly line. Their suffering is immense, unrelenting, and largely hidden.
Now, if I were to ask you which is the sickest animal on the planet, what would you say?
Humans.
Close, but it's not correct. Anyone has another idea?
Poultry.
And which poultry? The broiler chicken, you know? There are two kinds of chicken, the egg-laying chicken and the broiler chicken. And the broiler chickens are made to grow to full size in just 6 weeks. Normally, they grow to full size in 12 weeks. But they're made to grow to full size in 6 weeks and made to grow so breast heavy that they can't carry their own weight. And so if you were to rescue one of those white birds in those cages and put it in your backyard, it would die at the age of 6 weeks of a heart attack just by walking around. What will happen to us if we eat that? Like, if you've seen the village chickens and you've seen those broiler chickens, you can see a different shape even. The broiler chickens are round, right? So what will happen if you eat that? And the egg-laying chickens have another story that, you know, they are made to lay 250 eggs a year. Normal hen would lay 25 to 30 eggs a year because what will a bird do with more kids? But they are made to lay 250 eggs a year so that we can consume their eggs. And what goes into that? I'm just going to show you a quick video and explain this to you. So chickens, they're separated when the egg-laying chickens are separated into male and female. And the males are actually dumped, gassed, or ground up and fed to their sisters. So they make chickens cannibals. But anyway, they're fed to their sisters so that they get more protein so that they can lay more eggs. And the female chicks, their beaks are seared off and their toenails are seared off. This is their introduction to the world because they are going to be put in these cages where they can lay eggs and in such confinement that they can't even lift their wings. And so their frustration will, you know, not manifest into killing the hens next to them, their toes and their beaks are cut off. So this is a huge trauma and stress. And this stress, like us, they produce adrenaline when they're stressed. And this stress comes back to us through the adrenaline in our food. So we also get the feelings of the animals transmitted, their insecurity, their forsakenness, their hopelessness and despair, and their fear. And actually, if you stop eating all animal products, the cow is a similar story. A cow is artificially inseminated at the age of 2 so that she can produce a calf so that we can have the milk. And sometimes, most of the time, the colostrum is also sold. You know, the first milk is a delicacy and it's sold, which means that the male calf hasn't had even a drop of his mother's milk. So what happens to the male calf is calf leather and so on. But that cow is highly stressed because she wants to connect to her baby like all mammals, and then it results in adrenaline in the milk. So from a young age, we are desensitized by our society to animal cruelty and abuse because we go to circuses and zoos and we don't realize how much trauma the animals go through to do unnatural acts to entertain us or to be put in cages for life imprisonment just so that we can look at them. And our culture desensitizes us so that we can absorb the message of profits over principles. So it's a lot of things to think about because actually we are not unkind and we, like other species, are compassionate. This monkey rescued this puppy and brought it up because the puppy had lost its mother. And when we're born, we're actually connected to animals. That's why kids can put their hands in an animal's mouth and all kids' books are full of animals because there's that connection which is taken away as we grow by this desensitization. So I live with a lot of animals and actually I learned a lot of the things that I'm talking to you today, not from books, but from the animals that I live with, because just watching them makes you reconnect to what nature intended for us that we've forgotten. So how can we make informed food choices? Just by reconnecting back to our instincts. And sometimes we think it's really difficult. Like, how could I live without dairy or whatever? And I just want to show you someone you know who's made the change. And I'm going to show him to you over 3 years. So he became vegan, almost vegan, in May 2010. And I'm showing you a video of September 2010, what happened to him in 4 months.
How did you lose so much weight? What kind of diet are you on?
The short answer is, I went on essentially a plant-based diet. I live on beans, legumes, vegetables, fruit. I drink a protein supplement every morning, no dairy. I drink almond milk mixed in with fruit and a protein powder. So I get the protein for the day when I start the day out. And it changed my whole metabolism and I lost 24 pounds. And I got back to basically what I weighed in high school. But I did it for a different reason. I wanted to lose a little weight, but I didn't ever dream this would happen. I did it because after I had this stent put in, I realized that even though it happens quite often that after you have bypasses, you lose the veins because they're thinner and weaker than arteries. The truth is that it clogged up, which means that the cholesterol was still causing buildup in my vein that was part of my bypass. And thank God I could take the stents. I don't want it to happen again. So I did all this research and I saw that 82% of the people since 1986 who have gone on a plant-based, no dairy, no meat of any kind, no chicken, turkey. I eat very little fish. Once in a while I'll have a little fish, not often. If you can do it, 82% of the people who've done that have begun to heal themselves. Their arterial blockage cleans up. The calcium deposit around their heart breaks up. This movement has been led by a doctor named Caldwell Esselstyn at the Cleveland Clinic, Dean Ornish, whom you know, out in California. The doctors Campbell, father and son, who wrote the China study, and a handful of others. But we now have 25 years of evidence. And so I thought, well, since I need to lose a little weight for Chelsea's wedding, I'll become part of this experiment. I'll see if I can be one of those that can have a self-clearing mechanism. We'll see.
Let's see 1 year later.
You talked about the fact that you love to eat. I mean, this is...
I know, I like the stuff I eat. I like the vegetables, the fruits, the beans, the stuff I eat now, I like. I like it.
Do you call yourself a vegan now then?
Well, I suppose I am if I don't eat dairy or meat or fish, you know.
So you've cut all that out. I mean, do you crave
the only
it?
Thing, once in a while, in, literally in well over a year now, at Thanksgiving, I had one bite of turkey.
This is actually an excerpt from a 42-minute film called The Last Heart Attack, which was made by Dr. Sanjay Gupta, and where he interviewed a lot of people, and you can find this on YouTube, where he interviewed a lot of people who have reversed their need for bypass surgery just by going on a whole plant-based diet.
And you just keep looking this better and better.
Later.
You look fantastic.
Look at his skin.
I'm vegan as well, and I know that you're eating plant-based diet, which is, do you just feel much better?
Oh, yeah. I think, I would say this, particularly if you're old.
Well, you look fantastic, and there's no way you're eating a lot of sugar, because you've lost, how much weight have you lost?
This is the third week in a row where I will weigh less than I did the day I finished high school.
Wow.
So how could he do it when he was such a burger lover? It's because when we start eating according to our instincts, we don't feel like eating the other things anymore. It takes some time to overcome those habits and those addictions. And that's why I conduct a 21-day disease reversal program, because it takes 21 days to change a habit. But, so if I hold their hand for 21 days, then they're going to be there forever. So what's really important is don't forget to look after yourself more than you look after your car. So that's basically it, and I would love to answer questions if you had it.
So is there a particular diet chart that you should follow? Is there something that you...
Actually, the most important thing is that animals don't have diet charts.
Okay.
So how can we learn to follow our instincts? So what I could guide you is how to, or I'll guide you on an ideal menu, say, huh? How can we eat only what's natural to our species? And then I have two simple rules. When you're hungry, eat. And when you're thirsty, drink. Like, whenever. Okay, it's that simple. And it's so simple that sometimes we overlook it. Kind of, right? But here's what. If you wanted to have an ideal menu, then I would start the morning with fruit. Remember, the tea and the coffee is gone because of that lady, and we don't want to have tea and coffee are also acidic. So we don't want
green tea.
And even green tea, green tea is advertised because of all those antioxidants. But all fruits and vegetables are full of antioxidants. So if you're eating fruits and vegetables left, right, and center, you don't need antioxidants from green tea. So basically, it's like taking all the things which are advertised mostly out. It doesn't mean that it has to be 100%, because our body has a lot of reserves. Like, we have two kidneys, we can do with one. We have two lungs, we can do with one. We have a huge liver, we can do with a part of it. Until our arteries are 70% blocked, we don't have symptoms. But we have managed to go beyond all our reserves. I'm treating right now a few patients of kidney failure. Dialysis, right? So how do we manage to go that far, and why should we? That's what's important. So if we could do even 95, if you're not sick, if you're sick, we need to do 100% because we've already gone beyond all our reserves. If you're not sick, even if you do 95%, right, you're almost there. Some reserves our body can deal with, some wrong our body can deal. So an ideal diet, what I would recommend, is fruit in the morning. Any fruit. This is for diabetics and non-diabetics and all. And then if you wanted a breakfast. And that breakfast would be your daily breakfast just converted into a whole breakfast. For example, if you were having idlis with sambar and chutney, then the idlis would be made with whole red rice and whole udad dal. And they taste wonderful. With sambar, which was made without oil, and chutney, same, you know, like everything with whole ingredients. And when I do even my one day programs, I always serve breakfast, lunch and snacks, just so that people can get it that healthy food tastes good. Now, if you want to get an idea of this, then Carrot's restaurant is just very close by and they have a lot of healthy plant-based food. So you could try it once and see what it feels like, you know. So, and then maybe if you wanted a snack, it could be nuts or fruit. And then fruit is nature's fast food, you know. You don't have to do anything, just... And then lunch would be starting with a salad. And then whatever was your typical lunch, like it could be whole rice instead of white rice with sambar and vegetables. Or any meal can be converted. And then a snack could be like a green smoothie. You take some spinach leaves and put some fruit in and make, it's really delicious. Doesn't sound, but it's worth trying. It's worth trying, really, because it's delicious. Or you could make like a date nut smoothie. You take ten soaked almonds and a spoonful of sesame and 4 or 5 dates and some water and blend it till it becomes like a thick shake. And it's like kind of like an almond milkshake, which is sweet and with some sesame seeds thrown in. So it's nutritious and everything. Or you could have like a sprout chaat or a sundal, or there are lots of things. And dinner is the same. You just convert whatever was your dinner into healthy dinner, but increase the fruits and vegetables. Like in South India, we do a lot of rice. And sometimes when you go out to eat and you get this thali, there's a mound of rice with these tiny little, and some people even leave some of that tiny little stuff. So how can we eat more vegetables and fruits, or the foods which are natural to our species, and reduce the other things? That's the whole idea.
Is honey a good replacement for sugar?
Actually not, because both honey and sugar have no fiber. And so what would be a good replacement is dates and raisins. So we make even desserts for our diabetic patients with dates and raisins. And yesterday, some of them came and said, I'm eating dates and I'm eating lots of fruits. And actually, they were enjoying what they were eating because they hadn't eaten those things for so long.
Dates, are the like commercially regularly available dates okay? Because they sometimes taste too sweet to be natural. Like,
dates are really, really sweet. But what's really nice about dates is, unlike sugar, they're not addictive. So, if you were to have...
So like these lion dates and all, they're okay.
They're okay. No, yeah, but the syrup again doesn't have the fiber. So, we don't want to use date syrup. And we don't want to use fruit juice because it doesn't have the fiber. We want to have whole fruits as far as possible. So, it means eating like a monkey. You peel only the fruits which a monkey would peel. You peel only the vegetables, which are only onions and garlic, which a monkey could peel, because a monkey doesn't have tools, he has only his hands. So a monkey would eat a mango like this, and so you don't need to eat the skin, but you need to eat every part of the fruit or vegetable which a monkey would eat.
Is it boiling the vegetables and all loose something or
the... Yeah, you know what, there are 5 stages of healthy eating. The first stage is a whole plant-based diet, where we even allow wheat and rice and things which we, but as long as it's whole. But the next stage would be, you know, the grains drop off by themselves. Once you start eating really good, just to give you an idea, like sugar is addictive. Right now you might feel, oh, without sugar, no desserts. How will I sweeten my coffee or tea, even though coffee and tea is out. But we think about sugar, right? But it's because we have got a certain threshold. And some people have 4 spoons of sugar in their tea. That's because their threshold is high. If you stop having the sugar, then it's like not having salt or getting used to less salt. You need less. And if you stop having the sugar altogether, then even carrots taste sweet and peas taste sweet. And dates taste really sweet and would be used only as a sweetener. And so your whole life change, you start liking the food, but you even start disliking the other. then the grains drop off by themselves. And so you feel like eating more vegetables and more fruit and things like that. And then the third stage is raw, because actually we're designed to eat raw. We've learned to cook. And the last stage is fruitarian. That means just fruits, or even the vegetables which are botanically fruit, just fruit. And the fifth stage is actually something which very few people are doing, but they're doing it living on light. Have you heard of breatharians or life people who live on light? We're eating much more than we actually need, and you can actually live. We also spend a lot of energy to digest the food. And so we're losing energy every time we eat. Sometimes, you know, you eat a big meal and then you can't even move because you're spending all your energy in digestion. So there are people who live on very little food or no food at all. But that's a spiritual process. Actually, you see a spiritual change, or even an emotional change, at every stage when you change your diet. But I would say, let's not think of all the other stages. We should just think of stage one, which is a whole plant-based diet, you know?
But you're talking about the holistic health, right?
Right.
Do you think only changing the food habits would suffice? Or
no, there are other things that we need, which is plenty of sunlight, rest at the right time, plenty of water, fresh air, exercise, etc. So we need all these things. But
food is amazing.
No. Food is the thing we neglect the most, and food is often the cause of disease.
So how would you reverse osteoporosis?
So you will reverse osteoporosis by understanding what is the cause of osteoporosis. And the cause of osteoporosis is not lack of intake of calcium, but the acid foods that you are consuming in your diet, which don't allow the calcium to be utilized. Which again means a whole plant-based diet with no tea, coffee, sugar, salt, alcohol, which are acidic. And before I end, I want to just say something which is very, very important, because I've said so much, and if you decide to do something or even test it out, what's really important is to do lab tests before you do it. And even without doing all this, many people have a deficiency of vitamin D and vitamin B12. And when you get on a whole plant-based diet, or when you get onto the right food for our species, our body becomes much more sensitive. And suddenly you start experiencing a lot, your body starts talking back to you. And it's important to know what your B12 levels are, what your D levels are before you start, so that you can supplement in case they're low, so that you can actually get the whole health rather than just looking for a few things.